it's always 1 square. So, this is r is equal to 2n. It's always pointing like this. Okay? And how much t changes is given by this one. So one of them is positive, one of them is negative. Whereas outside here, the future direct light cone is always towards larger t. Okay? So the light cone would be, sorry, here the light cone looks like this. Here it would look somewhat like this, I suppose. I suppose at this point, it's sort of bending. And here, it tilts down.
So the numerical value, then, if I do the dt by dr, it will be more than this.
Yes, the numerical value has no meaning.
You only have that time check how much velocity.
Yes, you have to, you know, you have to. The question is, speed of light is a question of, is the ray space light, null or light? The numerical value changes with change of coordinates. It's got no meaning. Okay, this is how the orientation. Yeah. Okay. Excellent. Okay. So this is our last lecture, and there's a lot of things I would like to. If you guys are grateful, if you could have these extra classes after December 15th on A, the theory of inflation, and B, some more details about that. Okay. Of course, I'm related to the course. But in this lecture. In this lecture, there are many things about blackboard physics that we should talk about and that I would sort of touch on. I want to read all details of everything just so that I can tell you about many things. Okay. The first thing about black holes that I want to tell you about is this notion of the event horizon. Okay? So, in this solution that we've talked about, in this particular solution that we've talked about, we see that there is this surface, namely r equals to m, beyond which things look different. I mean, they don't look locally different, they look globally different. Okay? And now you can ask, how do you invariantly characterize this difference? What is the clear statement? And the difference is this, you see, there are some regions of space-time from which a light ray can reach, let's say, square mass. And there are other regions of space-time from which it cannot. Okay? So some regions of space-time are causally connected to scribes. You have an observer here. You can receive signals. Or let's say you have an observer here. Some large constant dark. You can receive signals from the sky if he's here, but not from there. Okay? So now when there are some regions of space-time that have a property and other regions that don't, there's a boundary between regions. And the boundary between the regions of points that can communicate with scribe class and those that cannot, as a name, it's called the event horizon. Okay? So in this diagram, the event horizon is the surface. Now, this, of course, is a very simple solution. In this diagram, if you really write scribe class in this one, there are two scribe classes. Okay, so if you put scribe class prime, then the event horizon for that will be this guy. But let's say we choose the event horizon to find respect to this scribe class, that will give this event horizon. Right? Because anything to the left of it cannot communicate with scribe class, but anything to the right of it. Okay, now of course, having these two scribe classes and so on is an artifact for dealing with this internal plane, as we discussed. Okay. In the Penrose diagram of a black hole formed due to collapse, which looks like this, alright, there's only one. Okay. This confusion is not there. This is the event horizon. Okay, so this already brings you to a point that the notion of the event horizon is far more general than this particular static geometry. In particular, suppose we have the situation that we talked about at the end of the last class, we've got, let's say, the shell of light that is imploding, or a shell of dust that implodes. Okay? You know, to start off with, space-time could be very, you know, near flat everywhere. well, this implosion can cause cause the creation of black, as you see in such a Penrose diagram. Now, in this full space time, including full dynamical space time with all the dynamical details of the formation of the black hole, okay, there still is no there's still a separation between points in space time that can communicate with survivors and those that cannot. And there's a boundary between these two points. This boundary is called the event horizon. So this event horizon is well defined in a complicated dynamical situation that involves black hole formation. Or involves scattering of black holes. The red winds. Okay. Now, there are many things about the event horizon that are interesting. The first thing about it is that it is what is called a null event. So the event horizon is a manifold, it's a sub-manifold of the entire space-time. In four-dimensional space-time, it's a three-dimensional manifold. Any co-dimension one a sub-manifold, can be, you know, is conveniently described by some equation of the form S is equal to zero, where S is some scalar function. Okay. Now, given a manifold like this, there's the notion of the normal. So what is the normal to such a manifold? The normal to a manifold is a one-form whose components are del mu of S. Okay? Take the function S, take del mu of that, that gives you a one-form because it has lower indices. Okay? Now, so the normal to a manifold is characterized by one-form. You can also characterize by a vector, by basis. But most naturally, it's characterized by one form. Now, what is the defining property of this one form? The characteristic property is that, look, suppose S is equal to zero on this manifold. Then you start from a point on the manifold. You take del mu of S and multiply it by dx mu, such that dx mu stays on the manifold. That takes you to another point on the manifold where S is equal to zero everywhere. So this is equal to zero. Okay? So the normal one form is called the normal because it is orthogonal to all vectors that lie in the tangent space of this manifold, of the submanifold. Okay? Clear. Good. So, in Euclidean space, submanifolds are very easy to understand. You've got a normal vector and all your intuition to them applies. However, in Lorentzian space, something a little counterintuitive happens if you're used to thinking about Euclidean space. And the counterintuitive thing that happens is this map. You see, since we've got a manifold let's try to characterize these manifolds. It's clear, since there are three kinds of one forms, so three kinds of vectors. Qualitatively, three kinds of vectors. You know, one form could be either space like, time like, or not. Okay? So, it's clear that locally there are three distinct kinds of manifolds. Okay? Suppose you've got a space like. Suppose you're looking at a manifold whose normal is space like. You can always boost, go to coordinates in the local little patch so that your manifold is xi equal to 0 in a local Lorentzian system. Okay? So that the normal is given by del, is given by in the coordinates t, x1, x2, x3 as the component 1, 0, 0, 0. So one formula components 1, 0, 0. Okay? So that manifold is like space locally in some coordinate system can be thought of as space, the normal can be thought of as time. Such that manifold is space-like locally, always looks like that. Okay. On the other hand, the manifold can be time-like. In some appropriate coordinate system, the coordinates on the manifold could be taken to be t, x1, x2. The normal could be x3. Okay? So that's a time-like manifold. Manifold where the normal to it is space-like, the manifold includes two directions of space and one time. Okay. But the most interesting kind of submanifold in the Lorentzian space, are submanifolds where the normal is null. Okay. So, just to get some intuition for this, by appropriate coordinate changes locally, you can always take any null vector and put it in the form 1, 0, 1, 1, 0. Okay. Now, let's see what vectors lie, what local tangent vectors lie over this land. So that's everything that's normal to this. So of course,
0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 0, 1 lie within the manifold.
But in addition, one more vector lies in the manifold because the condition of normality is one condition of 4 dimensional vector space. It gives you a 3 dimensional vector space. Can you tell me what the third vector is? No.
1, 1.
1, 1. 1, 1, 0, 0. Because this vector is null. So it's in particular orthogonal to itself. Okay? So in a null manifold, the null manifold is spanned by two space line and one null directions. And the null direction is the normal direction itself. So in the null manifold, the normal vector lies in the manifold. So it's normal to the manifold, but also it's a tangent to the manifold. This is the thing that's really counterintuitive. This of course never happens in Euclidean space. Okay? Fine. Now,
is there any, even if you go normal to, in this direction, you stay on the manifold.
In what direction? In this direction, yes, you stay on. Okay. Yes, so this is a tangent vector. It's both normal as well as tangent.
So is there only one such manifold in the
One such manifold?
One.
Locally, of course. No, but there are many now.
No, I was saying flat space.
In flat space time. Let's see. Basically, any S such that its gradient is null defines a null manifold. Okay, so what does that mean? What we want is del mu S del mu S 0. Okay. Now, let's look at examples of such. So for instance, suppose we take a manifold that is where S is equal to S of X minus T. This will do it. But if we take S is equal to S of R minus T, that will also do it. So many things. Of course, X minus T and Y minus T are related to each other. But R minus T is not related to X minus T. Okay. Now, at least if you're not interested, if you're not wondering about possible singularities at some point, we could take a two-dimensional polar coordinate. These are just examples. You know, all you have to do is satisfy the singularity. Okay. Okay. Excellent. Now, why have I told you all of this? I told you all of this because we've just introduced the event horizon. Okay? Now, the event horizon is some sort of manifold. And we want to understand what kind of manifold it is. Okay? And of course, you know, when there's a particularly interesting surface and a particularly interesting kind of manifold, it is. It's going to be not a manifold. So what I want to prove to you is that the event horizon of any black hole is always a manifold. Okay? Now, why? The idea is very simple. Look, we'll show this by contradiction. Okay? Suppose we were on a Penrose diagram. Yes, it's 5 plus. It's almost obvious. That means, can you prove it? Suppose at some point the Manifold was space-like. I mean, had a space-like norm. Okay? So then in some local coordinate system, we could think of this Manifold as including time and two spatial directions. These two spatial directions are orthogonal to this board. This time is the one direction, the one normal spatial direction, and the two spatial directions are orthogonal. Okay, this is supposed to be out, this is supposed to be in. Okay, now this is claimed to be the surface of things that are that separate causal relations. So inside can never reach scriptless, but outside can. That's the claim. This is obviously impossible. Why? Because suppose the claim is that this point is causally disconnected with scriptless, but this point is causally connected with scriptless. Well, this point is causally connected with this point. Let's say I've drawn a long line trail. These two points are causally connected. So, a signal can go from here to here and then to scriptless. If a signal can go from here to scriptless. So, if a signal can go from here to scriptless, it can also go from here to scriptless. So, we've reached a conclusion. It's impossible that the surface that divides points that can and cannot communicate with scriptless has a space-like? No. Is this clear? Okay. Similarly, I want to now show that it's impossible that the surface that divides points that can and cannot communicate with scriptless has a timeline. Because suppose it was true, suppose we have some situation here. So suppose we have some event horizon here on this scriptless. And I go to coordinates where I make this look flat. Understand, right? But the normal vector is the time direction. All the vectors are going in the space directions. Okay, now this point is supposed to be able to communicate with scriptless, though these points can. Okay, but locally we can draw such a thing. So any curve that obeys causality, all the curves that obey causality from this point, eventually end up somewhere in this region. Okay, any curve within the local, little local light cone of this point eventually ends up in this region. So, if these points cannot communicate with scriptless, neither can this. Causally. Because, this event horizon is globally some very complicated surface. But locally, it's very simple. Causality is being met, it's like. Okay. So anything that emerges from here and goes in a time like a light-like trajectory eventually ends up here. But if it's true that none of these points can communicate with scriptless, neither can this point, therefore. And therefore it's a contradiction. It's impossible this is outside the event horizon, but this isn't. Is this clear? So neither of these possibilities. Both these possibilities give rise to contradiction. There's only one possibility left, namely that the event horizon is null. So it must be that the event horizon is null. Let's just say that if the event horizon is null, neither of the two objections that we looked at occur. Okay? Let's suppose the event horizon is null so that this 45 degree angle is null. The first contradiction was that, suppose this was inside and this was outside. Then we could draw some causally connected line from here to the outside and get one. But if this 45 degrees would come. So the first argument goes away. Similarly, the second argument was that every curve emerging from here ends up inside here. But if it's 45 degrees, it's not true. Now these things are going. Okay? So the objections that we raised don't apply if the manifold is null. It's the only possibility left. So the manifold is null. So the event horizon isn't null there. Remember what that means. What that means is that its normal is a null vector. Now, it's easy to convince yourself that in any null manifold, there is a unique null vector. Right? Suppose in this local coordinate system that we talked about before, there's a unique combination of these three that is null, namely this one. Anything else would be space. So, on any null manifold, there are no time-like tangents. Okay? And a unique null vector. Okay? What does this mean more physically? More physically, it means that if you shine a ray of light and you want it to propagate along your null manifold, this ray has only one way to go. That is along the normal, which also happens to be attached. Okay? Now, it's a little more involved, but anyway, let me just assert it and maybe it's intuitive to you. Suppose you do the following. You take the normal vector and you use that as a tangent vector to let me make the following assertion. Which I'm not going to try to prove at the moment. Just because we're in the last lecture of the course, a lot I'm going to say. If we do have these sessions in December, we go through all this. Okay. So suppose you take the heading on a null manifold. Any null manifold can be foliated by. Okay, so suppose we're looking at three-dimensional null manifolds of the kind that's relevant to n. Any null manifold can be foliated by two parameter set of null geodesics, such that the tangents to these geodesics at every point coincide up to normalization with the normal.
They are all length zero, right?
So they are what?
They are all of length zero.
Yes.
So how do we actually, go from one point to another by that?
You can go from one point to another even if it's of length zero. Light rays manage. So length is a formal notion. They move in space, they move in time. It's just we choose to call them lengths.
Can you repeat the question? Choose span instead of geodesics?
Yeah. That there is a two-parameter set of null geodesics which completely, I don't know what the right word is, that the manifold is the union of a two-parameter set of null geodesics. Let me draw that. Such that the tangent vectors of the geodesics at every point up to normalization coincide with the normal.
Both these geodesics are the same line.
No, right. So let me exactly not doing myself. What I mean is this, there's a two-parameter set of geodesics.
This isn't 3 plus 1
dimensions. I'm looking at null manifolds that are co-dimension 1 and 3 plus 1 dimensions. So the null manifold itself is 2 plus 1 dimensions. Or 2 plus 0. 2
plus 0.
Yes, it's null. Okay. So what I'm claiming is this. That if you take a null manifold, you can think of it as this null manifold is a three dimension. Along any ray, you cover one dimension. Okay? Now, there is a two parameter set of such rays which completely constitute the null manifold. Every point of the null manifold passes through one of these guys. Now these two parameter sets are A geodesics. Because they're null geodesics. Okay, and null geodesics. Okay? And in particular, if that is true, it's obvious. But anyway, I'm saying. See, it's obvious because there's a unique null, null vector at any point. Their tangents coincide with the normal up to normalization. Actually, I don't need to say the second thing. This is obvious. Because the tangent vector to null geodesic is null. Since these geodesics lie on the manifold, at that point, it's a null vector on the manifold, and therefore it must be proportional to the normal. Okay? Is the claim clear? Okay. Now,
this foliation is unique.
Is unique. You see, because it's a geodesic, because these are geodesics, it's obvious that it's unique. Take any point, solve the geodesic equation through that point. You know, light ray starts along the manifold, it's unique. Solve the geodesic equation, you get a unique solution. No, no. It's a unique null vector that points on the manifold.
This is not true for normal manifolds.
What? This is not true.
They can have non-unique foliation.
Shut. We give a physical interpretation. Sorry, what are you saying? For null manifolds. Okay? So, look, on the null manifold, there's a unique null vector. At any given point. Okay? So the tangent to the geodesic can only be that point. And the geodesic equation for the null geodesic equation is completely characterized by its tangent.
Is it two parameters then?
Yeah. Two parameters because this runs through a one dimensional line. Now you start with another point. You'll get another geodesic. But 2 plus 1 is 3. So to make up the whole manifold, you need 2 parameters and such.
So all the points on a null geodesic will be described by the
same geodesic. Well, by the?
Same set of parameters.
Well, a set of parameters that describe the geodesic. Of course, as I was going to be telling you about, you can try to parameterize the manifold by affine parameter along geodesic and weak geodesic. So if you want a parameterization, manifold.
To check, this is a consequence of the fact that we are telling you as telling it is 0, right? If it was m square or something.
That it was 0, yes.
I mean, if it's not 0, then you have to figure out two directions.
Yeah. You see, suppose it was non-zero. Suppose we had a manifold being time. Meaning, by which I mean a space-like normal, right? Time is part of the manifold. Okay? Now, basically, if you want to span this manifold by geodesics, what you would do is imagine that you've got dust particles on this manifold. You choose an initial surface, and you give them arbitrary velocities at the initial time. Many different ways in which you can give them velocities. All of which will give you geodesics that make up the manifold. Okay, you would have to lie. Hey, firstly, it's not even clear that... you see, there are many things about this. Firstly, an arbitrary submanifold, there won't even exist geodesics that will stay on the manifold. The arbitrary geodesics will leave the manifold. There are various things about it. Okay? So it's not even clear that it's possible to foliate it by geodesics. Okay? When it's possible, it's not clear, it's not true, that it's unique.
The
only
thing that changes in two dimensions, let's say, is the number of parameters required.
Yes. This is a very general thing that applies to two dimensions, 10 dimensions. Okay, so in a 10-dimensional space, you would have a 9-dimensional event horizon. But you have an 8-parameter set of parameters. Okay? So, now, in the context of the event horizon, what are these null geodesics? These null geodesics are the rays of light that are trying to make it out to scry plus, but never quite making it. You see, outside the event horizon, there are light rays that go to scry plus. Inside the event horizon, it's nothing that goes to scry plus. All light rays fall into the city light. But on the event horizon, there are these light rays that are at the edge. They don't quite make it to scry plus, neither do they fall into the city light. They just stay suspended. in particular in our particular black hole, these light rays are staying here, are we close to it? Okay? So these light rays, so these are the light rays that when you're on the event horizon, you try to shine your torch outwards. This goes as far out as it can, which constitutes neither going out nor going. And these are the geodesics that make up your event. No, they're not parallel in the sense that they can expand. Area increases. Yes, good. It's a good point that if your space-time is I'm going to describe that. Okay. Is this clear? Any questions about this?
If a dust particle or something penetrates the event horizon and that light which is suspended at event horizon gets scattered by it, it can leave the surface.
Well, there is another null direction that's inwards.
Yeah.
So it could go in. Suppose you've got a ray of light that's going along the horizon, and then you somehow scatter it, it could go inwards. But it cannot go out. You see, all scattering happens within your light. And all the event horizon. This is your light. It's scattered here, but not out. Because that only prevents you from going out. Okay? Excellent. Now, of course, no, I should say that these light rays are fictional. And nobody's claiming that there actually are light rays stuck there. So they might.
What if some metal falls into an R equal to 2m increases?
What if the metal falls and R equals 2m increases? Then that tells you that in such a space time, R equals 2m is not quite the event horizon. So, very good question. So, the question was. Okay. Without us sending it to you, can you take this as the last problem here? In your problem set? Consider d squared is equal to minus d squared into 1 minus 2 mv of by r plus 2d, I think it's minus 2dv. Okay, this is the Vaidya metric that describes black hole formation due to things falling in particular light. Okay, it's the kind of thing you have in mind. Because M is a function of V. Okay? Because M is a function of V, it's changing. Now, if M was a constant, the event horizon manifold, would just be precisely M is equal to 2M is equal to R is equal to 2. Okay, the exercise. Suppose M is varying, but slowly. Okay? So that M dot is smaller compared to whatever should be smaller compared to. Or maybe M squared. Okay, let's think more carefully. M is a length. So I want to dimension this condition. M dot. Maybe it's just one of these things. I think these units. No, M is length. This one. So I just want to. But if you need to assume that it's smaller compared to something else, make that assumption. M dot is very small. Okay. Compute the event horizon of this map, given this, and given, also given,
that m of b tends to m naught as b goes to infinity, and it tends to this faster than anything that you want. Let's say that the tending is exponential. Okay, then it, at large times it approaches m naught very fast. Given these two things, compute the event horizon in a power series expansion. This will answer your question. Okay? All you need to do in order to do this is to remember that the event horizon is a null manifold. So in order to answer this question, try to write down the manifold. Manifold is described by some S of R, comma V. That's equal to 0. Because there's no angle in the problem. It's going to be null. And it has to, at late times, tend to R equals to M naught. These two things completely define the manifold. Compute the manifold. It's not a difficult exercise. It's an interesting exercise. And, what you will find is that at time V, to leading order in your derivative expansion, at any given time V, R will be equal to 2M of V. But there will be corrections to this suppressed by derivatives. Find the first non-trivial.
What should be taken as a definition of non-static space?
So null manifold that separates curves and communicate with square class from those that cannot.
The whole reason.
You've got your space time. Scribe class is well defined. Some points can communicate with scribe class, some points can't. Okay?
Time doesn't matter.
It's a purely geometrical thing. Can you draw a causal curve that goes from this point to scribe class? If you can, it's outside the event horizon. If you cannot, it's inside the event horizon. Please.
So, you have null manifold for a black hole. So, that problem you described, when two black holes come together and they form one event horizon at some point.
Yes,
I want to know what happens to, WS.
So the event horizon manifold becomes singular at some point. No, it's always true. What happens though is that the event horizon topology changes.
Yes, in one case you have this condition, then you start with 0.
In but every case,
you have two disconnected.
Yes.
And when you bring them up, it suddenly becomes 1.
Yes. So, look at this term. For instance, suppose you look at the following equation in two dimensions. Okay. Suppose you look at the equation x squared minus y squared is equal to alpha. Let's plot these curves when alpha is positive. Okay, so y is equal to 0, x is something, so this is alpha positive. Let's plot the curve when alpha is negative. Symmetrically, so it looks like this. What happens when alpha is 0? This is x plus y, x minus y is equal to 0. It goes like this. And alpha positive, alpha negative, you've got smooth curves. The manifolds. Alpha equals 0 is not a manifold. It's from these two things coming. So this is what's going to happen locally. Okay? You have two event horizons. Sometimes they touch in some similar way.
They'll
open up.
The null vector will be 2 diagonal.
Yes, it would. Yes, it would. At that point, at the time that it touches, it's not a manifold. Manifold by definition, every local patch is isomorphic to R. At that point, it's not. So you can talk about it. You can use the manifold notions just before, just after, but not. Okay, this is a singular thing to the event horizon. No claim for singularity in physics. Just this concept, auxiliary concept that you define, develops a singularity. Okay, fine. Now, I want to tell you more about these event horizons. Okay, and Okay, just so that we finish what we're talking about, I'm going to prove things very lightly. Beautiful discussion in Thompson's chapter 6 of these projections. So, for those who are interested, I strongly recommend that after this class, you go and read chapter 6. The thing that I'm going to demonstrate, I'm going to tell you about, is one of the classic and most important theorems of general relativity, namely Hawking's area increase theorem. To do this, we're going to start. A collection of geodesics that foliate a manifold. It's called a congruence. It's just a name. Okay? So, collection that foliates a manifold, you use the word congruence. So, what I've already told you is that any null manifold admits a null congruence, null geodesic congruence. The congruence of null geodesics. Okay? Now, what we're going to try to do is to understand how these congruences evolve in more precisely affine parameter along these lines. So I'm going to try to tell you more precisely what I mean. Okay? So now let's look at any given manifold. At any given point, it has its tangent vector, and I'll call it t. Okay? Now, this tangent vector in some local coordinate system, as we've said, could look like 1, 1, 0, 0. Okay. Now, what I want to do is, suppose we had a congruence of time-like curves. Then, given any particular curve, there's a three-dimensional, there's a distinguished three-dimensional subspace. Spatial subspace. That's a spatial subspace that's orthogonal to the tangent at any point. Okay. However, suppose you've got a null congruence. Okay, or just a null geodesic. Doesn't matter. That's congruence. So you've got a null geodesic. And I say, let me look at the orthogonal subspace. Okay? The space of vectors that is orthogonal to this this geodesic at any point. This, of course, as we've seen, includes the geodesic itself. Okay, it's again a three-dimensional space, but it includes the geodesic itself, because the geodesic is not. Now, what I want to do is somehow define a spatial direction that is orthogonal to this subspace. Okay? The kind of thing that I want to do is to focus on these two directions. I want to focus on the xy directions. For what reason do you see? Okay? So, So what I want to do is to focus on the xy directions of this. Okay, so in order to do that, how could I do that? Well, one way of doing it is the following. Look, another vector number called A. Okay, in this coordinate system. I have this spatial vector 1 minus 1 zero. Now let's look at the algebraic relations made by n. Firstly, of course, t squared is equal to 0, t is equal to 0. Also, n squared is equal to 0, n is not. Okay? But what about t dot n? Okay? T dot n is, right, so t dot n is 2. So let me put a 1 by squared. So t dot n is equal to 0. Okay? So what I'm going to do is the following. Along my, okay, now I've got this null geodesy. So suppose I've got a vector n such that t dot n is equal to 1 at some point. And then I take the vector and parallel transport it along the geodesy. Now parallel transport doesn't change scale. We know that the tangent vector along the geodesic changes by parallel transport. If n also changes by parallel transport, then in particular, t squared, n squared, and t dot n all don't change. Okay? So given one such vector, okay, which I've chosen if there's any ambiguity in the way, on the geodesic, and then define like a field of such vectors, or one parameter set of such vectors, okay? Along the geodesic, I define it by parallel transport. Okay. So my definition of ways, in particular, it obeys the condition that t dot v of n mu is zero because the n mu field is defined by a parallel transport. So it is not changing the parallel transport. Okay. Now, given this p and this n, okay, for any geodesic, I define the projector orthogonal to tn. How do I do it? Well, here in this case, what would we do? We would want eta mu mu. Okay, we're on minus eta mu mu because it's space negative. Okay, and then I would want to get rid of the 1-0 parts. So I want to do something like plus t mu n mu plus t mu n. And now we check whether this works. Okay, so this thing is minus 1, 1, 1, 1. This guy, let's look at 0, 0. So 0, 0 gives 1, no, sorry. Yeah, this thing with the minus is minus 1, 1 by 1. And this thing 0, 0 with t mu n mu would give 1, 1, 1. Well, both ways would give 1, 1. The 1 by square root 2 would get half. Yeah, so this works. Okay. Well, with the space guy, that will also work. Yeah. So this quantity here would just become 0, 0. Something you change. Okay? So this operator gives you a projector onto a two-dimensional space-like plane, orthogonal to both the tangent and its null counterpart. Okay, it's projecting onto a two-dimensional spatial area. This
null part is not unique, right?
Yeah. Is it unique? I was wondering about that. Let's think that through. Let's work it out here.
Presumably it isn't. Simply doesn't matter, just one thing. So, of course, what you could do is choose one and any normal vector here. That would be null. And then by normalizing this appropriately,
you could get the inner product to be 1. Right. So this is not unique. It's not unique. And it's not going to matter what we choose. What is important is that once you've made one choice, you then make the same choice all through, and that's this equation. That is, once you've made one choice in nmu, the nmus along the geodesic are then defined by parallel transport. So how do you define? Okay, so let's say things. So we got these. This another component. You take some slice, let's say some space-like slice, okay, that cuts it. On the space-like slice, you get to make a choice of this n, one for each time it cuts there. You get to choose this. But after this, so there's ambiguity. But after that, how it evolves along the geodesic, it's ambiguous. Okay, that's all we will need to prove with this. Okay. And there's something that's going to give me up. Okay. Yeah. Now, I'm going to tell you about various things that you can very simply prove. Maybe the first of these are true for you. And then various little algebraic exercises I'm going to do that are very simple to prove. They're all very, they've worked out very detailed in terms of section notes. I'll prove one of them for you. But the important thing is, at the end of these algebraic exercises, what does it mean? Okay, so let me start. Okay, so the first thing that you can prove is what? Suppose P times zeta is equal to at any one point. So suppose you've got a little vector in the tangent space about one point around any geodesic. Okay, this vector lies in your orthogonal direction. So this projector was P. P is the orthogonal projector. Okay. So suppose P times eta is equal to eta. That is, you've got a vector that is orthogonal, that is in your two-dimensional spatial space, whenever you're defining it. Spatial space. Okay, excellent. Now, just let it be. Yeah, let it be. Excellent. Okay. Okay, so the thing I'm going to try to prove is the following, that if P times eta is equal to eta, that P at one point lies within this, then you have the following. You have the following equation. You have d eta mu, where d means derivative of the tangent. So d mu d mu. Okay, is equal to P mu lambda, P lambda rho, P rho nu. And when P is
this is good now, lambda rho nu.
equation say? I'm going to try to prove it for you, and the rest of the lecture I will prove it. Write down a equation. But let's prove this one. It's the most important. Just to show you how easy it is. Okay. So, but what is this equation saying? This equation is saying that the evolution of eta along the geodesic is given by some linear transformation on eta. Okay. So that if you try to you try to parallel transport this this vector eta, it rotates in some way that depends on eta. But the important point, of course, this model is obvious, but anyway, the important point is that you've got these projectors. So the change in eta is always in the projector directions. So what I mean is that suppose you take some eta that lies in this two-dimensional subspace, orthogonal to both these double vectors, both these null vectors. Okay? Then you take this eta and transport it by parallel transport along the geodesic. It remains orthogonal to this null subspace. It's more or less obvious. But it remains orthogonal, and it remains orthogonal by this rule. You get a particular rule for how this thing moves along. Okay. Now, let me try to show you this this proof. It's very simple. Okay. Let's start by like t dot t of eta. So this is what you want. This is equal to t dot b of phi mu nu eta nu, because t dot d on n and p dot d on t are 0. So p mu nu, so what is eta? What is p mu? P mu nu is eta mu nu, okay, plus n mu t nu plus the other mu. But t dot d of both n and t, let me write this again. T dot d of t is equal to 0, this is a geodesic equation. And t dot d of n is equal to 0, this is a defining equation of this field. Okay? So as far as this operator t dot d is concerned, both t mu and n mu are constant vectors. Okay? So, we can, you know, add this p mu nu basically for free. Because you can just pull the vectors outside. You see? Okay, let's write this out. This is t dot d of eta mu nu plus n n mu t mu plus t mu n mu acting on eta. Okay, but this gives 0 on this, so just take this on this side, and that's 0. that's what we're talking about. I'm sorry, I overcomplicated things. Sorry. I'm sorry, people. This was an obvious thing. This is just because P eta is eta. Okay? So I've just written eta is equal to P eta, so this is a triviality. Sorry. Okay. But now let's see. So the next step is we'll write this as this is equal to. Now I can bring the P mu nu out because T dot del commutes with P mu. Alright? So I can write this as P mu nu times T dot del on eta nu. Okay, because of these two terms. Okay. And now we had this definition of V where we had V nu rho is equal to what was it? Del rho T. Okay? So now the next step in this derivation is supposed to be, this is supposed to be P mu rho nu times P mu rho nu. the zeros of lambda. Okay, you know, you've got affine parameters along each of these geodesics. Now these affine parameters can be shifted by anything independently, geodesic by geodesic. Okay? Now what I'm going to do is to take these little orthogonal vectors that are normal to A. Okay? And define that if lambda is equal to 0 here, lambda will be 0 along the line everywhere. Okay, so that gives you a surface of constant lambda. This defines your surface of constant lambda. Now, with this definition, this is the surface of constant lambda. Clearly, these vectors, these n vectors, are the vectors del by del y alpha at constant lambda, or they're proportional to them. Right, because you're going from one geodesic to the other, but at constant lambda. Okay, so these n vectors can be thought of as proportional to del by del y alpha. Okay, these eta vectors. We thought it was proportional to del by del y alpha. Okay, but now del by del y alpha at constant lambda commutes with del by del lambda at constant y alpha. But del by del y alpha. Lambda constant y alpha is the tangent vector. Okay? So these vectors here can be chosen to commute with the tangent vector. And that is actually what we need for this. So let me write that down. You see, by my eta vectors, I mean del by del y alpha. Okay? I mean del by del y alpha. Then we have that that these vectors commute, and therefore t mu on let me show you this. Okay, so suppose I'm sorry about this. Let's start again. So t is this vector that we've talked about before. It's tangent to these things, and del eta alpha is the vector del by del y alpha. That comes. Okay, now these vectors commute. T commutes with both eta alpha. Okay, so that tells you that t mu d mu of eta mu alpha. So if I act with a displacement on this, t mu down. D mu of eta mu alpha minus eta mu alpha del mu of t mu is equal to 0 by definition of the vectors commuting. Okay. Now, because this is true, it's also true that t mu del mu of eta mu alpha minus eta mu alpha del nu t nu is equal to 0. And the reason that this goes to this is that the two terms cancel because of symmetry. You see, the way they differ is by a term that is t nu gamma nu nu theta eta theta alpha, and this one is eta nu alpha gamma mu nu theta t theta, but these are the same. Okay, the point is that this the only non-zero index is here. Okay, so these two are now the same. But this quantity is what we call B. Okay, that's here. And this quantity is what we had, T dot D times eta is what we had here. Okay, so you can replace this, by an eta dot B, and that gives us this. Okay, sorry about that. So let me summarize again. Okay. So the etas for which we're doing this are the del by del y alphas. Okay? Because these etas commute with the vector t, this goes over to this, and we've got this equation. And once we've got this equation, we can rewrite this as p b p eta, because p of eta is. Okay, so we prove this equation that we want. Sorry about that. That mess up. What is important here is the fact that t and eta commute. That t and eta commute. I'm trying to find how these normal vectors evolve as we move.
And these normal vectors define surfaces.
Yeah, these normal vectors define sort of coordinates of itself. I'm trying to see how the surface that's evolving, how it shears, compresses, and moves. Okay, now we've just got like a few minutes left. Let me very quickly tell you what's important. Okay, now from this equation, okay, we've got this important quantity B. Now this B here, just as a matter of decomposition. So B is an effectively 2 cross 2 matrix because it's orthogonal to the other directions. It's a matrix. It's really a 4 cross 4 matrix, but it's projected on both sides. So it's effectively like a 2 cross 2 matrix. Okay? And there's some standard stuff you can do. You can define theta equal to this B hat mu mu. So B hat is equal to P, B, B. Okay, so theta is equal to B hat mu mu, sigma hat mu nu is equal to B hat mu nu, symmetrized minus the trace part. And omega hat mu nu is equal to B hat mu. Okay, and so this is the answer. So in terms of this of these components, B hat can be written as is equal to half theta P mu nu plus sigma hat mu nu. Omega hat. So what I've done is I've taken an arbitrary 2 cross 2 matrix and write it as symmetric traces plus anti-symmetric plus trace matrix. Okay, so it's just that decomposition, which you can do by any matrix. Okay, now two three quick things. You see, one thing you can prove. Now, we're applying this now to the null geodesics that go around the event space. Okay? We haven't yet here used that this congruence of null GOD6 is the congruence that is normal to a null manifold. At the moment, it's just any bunch of length trace. Okay? That it's normal to that this congruence is the congruence of the normals of a null manifold allows you to show,
and I will try to do it now,
that omega has this unit.
Okay? That vorticity is this omega.
For the case of null manifold, there are omegas, which is zero. So it's, vorticity free flow. These fluid particles are moving so as to generate essentially vorticity free flow with just shear and compression. Okay, great. Now, Reichardt thing. So all this is very nice, but the most important thing comes as follows. Again, using manipulations that are of the sort that we described, that are again described very nicely in these lecture notes, Wright Chaudhry formed the following equation. He found an equation for the derivative of the shear as you move along these GP6. Okay, he found the following equation. That d theta by d lambda is equal to minus theta squared by 2 minus sigma mu sigma mu g plus omega mu nu minus r mu t mu t. And basically all you start by d theta, in order to derive this, you start by d theta by d lambda is equal to t dot del, just a definition of d mu nu p mu nu, because this is what theta is, the trace of this b. And then you use various manipulations, all the time using that you are using the geodesic equation and the fact that the n's are transporting them. Okay, with a few line manipulations, you can start with this equation and reach this beautiful one. Okay, now, the thing to note is the following. This thing here is negative definite. This thing here is negative definite. You might wonder, is it really negative definite? Because perfect squares and relativity can be either positive or negative, depending on whether this makes life or time length. But theta, of course, is a scalar. And sigma is a tensor completely in a space-like direction, because it's in orthogonal projective direction. Okay? So this guy here is negative definite. This guy here is negative definite. This guy is positive, but it's just zero for the case of interest. Okay? So it's not there. And then you also have this thing. Okay. Now, notice that the thing that's multiplying r mu nu in this term is a null vector, namely the tangent vectors along these geodesics. So now let's use Einstein's equations on this side. Einstein's equations relate r mu nu to t mu nu and to t times g mu nu. But the g mu nu part vanishes because the t's are null. T, g is zero. So you can basically take this and replace this by t with the right.